to Denise, Brett, Mark, the, of course, our Secretary Spaulding, wonderful panel. And you've heard a little bit about what boards at the top have to be to manage and think about. We're going to take it way back down to the organization now, where the rubber meets the road. So where that happens, of course, is with the security professional. And our next panel actually gets into, you know, how do folks at that security practitioner layer deal with some of the ethical challenges, the professional challenges, and everything else related to being, frankly, a hacker, whether you're a white hat, a black hat, or a big old gray that's in the middle between those two things. So I'd like to introduce our moderator, Josephine Wolf, who's the assistant professor of public policy and computer science at the Rochester Institute of Technology. She researches everything related to sort of security policy, and specifically the impact of social and political dimensions of cyber breaches. Say that sometimes, Josephine. And so please join me in welcoming Josephine, our MRC panel.
Talks and discussion. We're going to close out the afternoon, and we know a lot of you have been in this room for a while now, with what I hope will be a lively discussion about hacking for the better good, or ethical hacking, and whether there are certain circumstances where the things that we usually think are wrong, the things that we try and discourage in various ways, both technical and legal, are maybe not so wrong, right? We usually try not to have people take other people's machines offline without their permission. But what if those machines are attacking people, attacking other people? We usually don't think it's a good idea for people to be buying a lot of stolen data on the black market, but what if it's your data, or what if some of it's your data? And we're going to talk about whether there are some exceptions for thinking about certain circumstances where we might want to encourage those kinds of activities under ethical guidelines, what those guidelines should be, how we distinguish, how we try to make sure that we don't then leave huge loopholes for the criminals to climb through by saying there are certain circumstances can do these things, and what kinds of guidance you might want if you're going out into the world of ethical hacking to take up some more active defense posture, how you know that you're staying on the right side of the law and on the right side of ethics. So here with you today to talk about this, we have right next to me, Lance James, who is the chief scientist at Flashpoint and the former chief of cyber intelligence at the Deloitte. Next to him, Nick Stella, who is the deputy chief for computer crime at the U.S. Department of Justice. And finally, on the end, Michael Tiffany, who is the co-founder and CEO of White Ops. So I want to start off by talking about whether there's actually a distinction between the kinds of technical activities that we see in the ethical hacking world and the not-so-ethical hacking world. Whether things that the good hackers, the white hats do, are actually substantively different from the things that the black hats do, and how we can think about making those distinctions, or whether we really can make those distinctions in anything other than who you are and what the circumstances are. Michael, I'm going to go over to you first to talk a little bit about your thoughts on that, sort of what you think of as defining ethical hacking versus black hat hacking.
Okay. All right, I'll start off with something that I think is strongly counterintuitive, which is that in extremely difficult trying challenges, white hats hugely distinguish themselves from black hats because this is a field that's full of real heads-up competition, which is weird in most of our daily lives, even in business competition. Business competition is usually the competition of a foot race, right? Like, who can go a little faster, who can do it longer? Whereas when we're talking cybersecurity, we're often talking about heads-up adversarial activities where I'm trying to win and the other guy's trying to win, one of us is going to lose. And when the stakes are very high, so we're talking about entry-level kinds of efforts, but for the really high efforts, there's actually a defender's advantage, which is counterintuitive, because I think that fundamentally, our adversaries are for the most part mercenaries. Right? So if we think about this historically, militaristically, mercs only fight so hard. And often the difference between winning and losing is not the intelligence that you bring to the problem in hour number one, it's actually the intelligence you bring to the problem in hour 10,000. And that's where actually the white hats really distinguish themselves because If you're aiming for a kind of higher calling, if you're trying to make a world better place, then it's literally easier to motivate yourself to go farther than if you're just a merchant. That's one of the reasons why the threat landscape is what it is, where often we as defenders are not trying to achieve perfect security, we're just trying to get the bar high enough that we get adverse selection. It won't be our systems that are victimized, someone's going to think they're victimized. And that dynamic is fundamentally different in black versus white, which I think is really interesting.
How about you? You
feel
the strong
I do actually, because I love the possible perspective you have, even in a physical fight, it's the same way, even in principles play fight. I also think that there needs to be some glossaries of definitions going on in it, because active defense and active response. One, there are three major modes, like passive, active, and basically active, right, during warfare, basically, in that sense. So there are techniques that we win on. So for instance, also bringing up the cost of warfare, but also that we understand the offensive engagement technique. You look at all day, all the time. And there are only so many maneuvers now, like a new exploit, things like that. But there's basically, you know what the steps are in attacking systems and things like this. What I think is very interesting is the technical differences and the weapons we have. Actually, there are two pieces that are really important. One, we work in trusted, vetted community, right? If I work with you or something like that, my relationship might be kind of confidential for a second or trusted, you know, and not for a sneaky way, but more for I want to be protected when I'm discussing this, it might be something that we're working on to stop a hack. Right. So it's not advertised publicly. You don't find out until it's like, bam, dark code's down, or bam, critical offer's down, right? Bam, APT1, we got applications, you know, those kind of things. The things that I'm very proud of, by the way, at the FBI that have done a great job, right? So, but there's also, that's the tool. Like, for instance, in passive sinkholing, right? It's an interesting concept, and it's a very powerful weapon when it comes to intelligence. Give an example, the crypto locker is a good one where it went from passive to actually being able to prevent an actual problem. So we started, they had all these domains registered. We were able to work with the domain registrations and get them all up to a certain point. And what happens, you watch, because we didn't realize this until we actually started doing it, that if you could put that in a proxy and generate all those domains in advance, like days ahead or months or even years, you could have a year ahead. And you put that in your proxies in your organization from an operational defense perspective, right? You knew that crypto lock was in there, but it blocked the actual traffic from encrypting your actual life stuff. So you're like, I identified, I also prevented, and I can quarantine remediate, right? Now, this is getting ahead of that threat, but we don't advertise it. We don't say this is what we're going to do. And I find out that you talk about cost of warfare, that MERV thing is that humans don't have a wow loop, right? Like, they don't have something where they can keep going like this. But like, for instance, if they set a new domain generation algorithm inside of me, we just reverse it in a day and do the same thing for the entire effort. So we have actually an advantage because if we're more efficient, more strategic. The best words I think you were trying to say is they're mission-oriented, is basically mercenary. We're strategy, strategic, defense-oriented. Like, we're looking at across the 10,000 yards, right? Whatever, 10,000 miles. So I think when we look at it, our defense is going to be a little bit more lucrative as a community in some senses, and it's very distinct compared to that. And in a lot of ways, when you're doing sinkholing or things like that, there's permissions, there's privacy issues that you have to deal with. But in the community, the crypto locker, the reason why I bring it up is it was a great example of a community getting together very quickly to take down an epidemic that it was less than a year, actually, which was like almost like unheard of. And it was the community, like for once there wasn't these, like, there were still NMAPs, there were still all these things in place, but the industry helped broker some of the information that needed to get to the right places without having such complications. And they didn't do it with the direction of by law enforcement, we just did. And I think that's actually a key thing.
We did it in conjunction.
We did
it in conjunction. Right, so the crypto
locker takedown.
I'm going to go a little back, unless everybody's already familiar with the crypto locker takedown that Lance is talking about, which was done. Correct me if I'm wrong, in conjunction with the Department of Justice and law enforcement. I'm wondering if you could talk a little to sort of the legal element of thinking about ethical hacking. It's one thing to be somebody who's working, you know, with the government, you feel pretty confident that you're not breaking any laws, you're not treading outside the bounds. How do you think about that if you're not involved in a sort of formal takedown like that, in terms of these are the things I can do with the community in the name of ethical hacking? Here's where I should start to get worried about the Freedom of Information Act, and here's where I can really cross over the line.
Yeah, so I mean, one thing I want to emphasize is that we do feel like the best model is when you do work with us. So if there are people out there in the computer security research community that have a great idea about how to mitigate a threat, but they have some concern that if they did this on their own, they might be running into other people trying to address the same problem. They might be attacking systems that themselves are victims, that bad guys are using as proxies. If they are just worried, I'm not sure this is legal. Coming and talking to the FBI, the Secret Services, or the investigative agencies, on the prosecution side, we have authorities that we can go to court and get permission to do a variety of things. That's the model we use to encrypt the locker. Certainly there were parts that were done by private industry to protect themselves that were separate and apart. But when you actually talk about taking down that network, the game over Zeus.net, and it as a distribution method for crypto locker, that was done by somebody outside of the government having a really smart idea about how to address the problem. Greater expertise than we could have brought to bear as investigators or government. We took that, we figured out how to get authorization to do it. The courts blessed it, checks and balances, everybody's rights protected. And today, game over Zeus is dead. So that, I think, is our preferred model. But I understand that even before we get to that, there are going to be cases where people are acting on their own. And there is a lot of legal uncertainty. I've had people say, my section will never go out of business because the laws that we interpret are so complex that nobody will ever get to a level of understanding sufficient to get rid of us.
Maybe I say one thing that's interesting, I think it's just that people have this. Every case that I've been working with, you know, you guys, or Secret Service on, I found that each, the law is insane. There is independent events in each scenario. So it is exactly right to like, go ask it. Please talk to your local, you know, your regional office, you know, things like this, because there are independent circumstances that will exist in exactly what you're saying. That, you know, how do you take it? And I think it's the most fun part is to be creative to figure out how to work within the law to actually take these steps.
Yeah, and we understand that this is a complex area. One thing that we've done to try to help is we created a cybersecurity unit. So typically what we did was we went to court and prosecuted after the fact. A computer crime happened. We tried to find out who did it and put them in jail. Well, that model just isn't going to work. Attribution is too difficult. We've got to find new strategies. We're trying to enable better prevention by using the cybersecurity unit to try and give people a greater understanding of those statutes that we deal with every day. The Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, the Wiretap Act, the Pen Trap Act, all those network monitoring and computer laws. We're trying to share what we've learned with the public so that they can understand what they can do to better protect themselves. And we're going to events like Black Hat and talking to the community about these are the things that you should not be afraid of. These are ways that if you are in an area that is a little bit gray, those factors that computer prosecutors, how we interpret criminal laws, how we use them, these factors that we apply to decide what to prosecute so that you can have a greater understanding of what is more likely to get you into hot water and allow you greater room to do those things that actually improve your security.
So I'm curious, one of the things I hear often, and I'm guessing some of you do as well, is from companies that feel they have greater technical expertise and visibility and ability to, say, go after the servers that are attacking them, than going through the Department of Justice and the legal process and getting court orders. They say, we're under attack right now. We can do something about this. And there's, first of all, a lot of uncertainty if you bring up around whether that's legal. And second of all, I think there's some concern that that can really backfire if you create a legal exception where you say, okay, if the server's attacking you, then it's all right to take them down. Then anybody can attack anyone they want, say, but they were attacking me first, right? So I have a legal cover. I'm curious if you could talk a little, and I'm sorry, I'm with Michael, and come down the line, about what you think are some of the risks involved with going deeper into a world of sort of trying to codify ethical hacking and how you dodge those.
Well, the speaking just as a practitioner, being very, very practical, I don't like hackback exceptions because they're manipulable. Like, we haven't cracked the attribution problem. And if I can fool someone into confidently thinking that they're being attacked by my real victim, then I can steer by proxy a whole bunch of attacks at someone that's completely innocent. And that kind of amplification attack happens today. That, like, this is one of the reasons why computer security is such an amazing field, because just when you think about a handle on it, someone kind of zooms out and comes up with, you know, a multi-level attack that uses your defenses against you. Any steps towards really cyber vigilantism, I think would end up just being a tool used by most clever black hats. So that's a terrible rule without even thinking about the principles, like, you know, not even considering, you know, the hermeneutics of the ethics involved. It's just going to lead to disaster.
Maybe
when
you're on the same page, that there shouldn't be
an
exception for
sort of
a white hat attacking.
Well, I obviously say it shouldn't be accepted for white hat. I think there ought to be limits. And the department has been pretty active in saying there's plenty of active defense that you can do short of hacking back. And hacking back is where we draw the line, because it's unlikely to be effective. If they take in your data is gone. The idea that you're going to get it back is vanishingly small. You are as likely to be attacking another victim as you are a true bad guy. And frankly, what we've done is we understand it does take time, but our system of checks and balances makes a call about when it's appropriate to do this. And what we've done is we've created a protocol that we've shared with the specialists out throughout the entire country about how to do this with court authorization. So if you really think the right answer is quickly moving to go take your data back from the server, you've seen it leave, you don't think it's left the place it's gone to, you can come to the FBI, the Secret Service, a federal prosecutor, and we've put together a plan to try and have a quick response if you think that's effective. I haven't had anybody take me up on that offer yet, because I think people realize it is unlikely to be effective.
I want to, sorry, we're kind of here for a second, I just want to drill down when you say there are a lot of ways to do active defense short of hacking back. Let's talk concretely. What can you classify as active defense? What can I do? When do we get into the hacking back
territory? Well, certainly the new CyberSecurity Act has made pretty clear that things that you do on your own network are okay. And even allows some activities to occur on other people's networks with their consent. So if we're talking about a situation where you've seen your data leave and it's on some third-party server, instead of just trying to break into that server and take it back, call them up. I mean, if it's really the bad guy, you're not going to have any luck, but as likely as not, there are a waypoint for this data, and they are likely going to be cooperative in trying to get your data back. But there's many variety of things, and being that I am a lawyer, it would be probably not the best for me to expound on all of the network defense things.
Let me show
you
how to do it.
Yeah.
Well, actually, if you'll mind, I'll tap your button and try to expand on that a little bit. But as the not lawyer in the room, it's interesting. I've had some very, there are, again, like, so when I was at Deloitte, what we did first, and to me, I actually find hacking back, that's what I do, because with like law enforcement, because I sort of go, if you think about the word hacking, it's a creative way of doing something and making it happen that usually doesn't, you know, the usual kind of way, go with the MIT hacker way. It's like, you know, making it do something more progressing, right? Well, in a way, part of that hack is, okay, you come to me and say, you can't do it that way. Sorry, we can't do it, you know, here are limitations, and I go, okay, how can I be creative and how can I make this work within the confines of the law? To me, that's a form of hacking. It may not be bits and bytes all the time, but it's a form and it's an art form and a tradecraft that is required to understand how to actually succeed in active defense working law enforcement. So, technically, I know what you're saying about hacking back. I just wanted to say that in my opinion, I find that it's even more of a more thing. But basically, there are issues that are going on. Like, for instance, when we were at Deloitte, we had a whole agent that would come, like maybe one or two agents that would come stay with us for a few times a week, right? Then we built it like they're part of our team, right? You know what I mean? And that way, we had oversight. We understood, you know, like what they can do. Plus, there have been cases that we're seeing stuff, right? You know what I mean? And this is, I know some companies will freak the heck out of it. Trust me, there was a time that I trust me, I can do this way. But basically, it, you know, that relationship. There's also groups out there, like organizations like NCFPA, which provides a proxy for giving information or turning information, and they have analysts. And they have where you can be partners in and be analysts sitting in those offices accessing that intelligence once you're vetted and you know, approved and stuff. So that you're not necessarily like, I work for the government, you don't have to have the world, you don't have to say the caveats there, because there is benefit being a citizen and not a government worker. But there are systems out there that have been out for a while, I wish you could take a little bit more marketing. But they're starting to, you know, they're starting to expand, they're starting that those things are gonna happen. And I find that it's really just gonna be, it's mostly a community effort. It's like if we're all talking to each other, where we're, you know, when we have that, I think that's where we know where our lines are gonna be drawn. So you just don't be afraid to ask the question, don't be afraid to propose an illegal idea and find out how to make it, you know, or like go back to like here's a new
plan. Well, on that note, I have a question for you along those lines. Earlier this morning, Brian Krebs gave us all the different software that we would find our data on the black market. So let's say my data as it has been many times, and I decide, you know, I'm really sick of all these credit monitoring things that I really like to do, so I have to buy it back. Is that legal? Is it, how do I do it? Sort of where does that go? If you say I'm not allowed to take offline servers that are DDoSing me, I'm not allowed to, you know, go after my attacker servers. How about my data once you're out there? What if my data is part of a lot of 10,000 people's data and I can't buy it as mine? Where do I start sort of trying to figure out what I'm allowed to do and what I'm not allowed to do?
So, I will start this, and I definitely want your guidance on like kind of more of the legal perspective, but we were just discussing the backstage. So I literally got assigned at work to build a buyback protocol. This has come up, even though we don't encourage it, our job and stuff like this, but it does come up. It's working. Deep dark web, you see the stuff that's going on, right? So if we see it, well, you know, we got to find a way to get it to them, and it's a victim notification. And again, NCFPA has a proper victim notification system too, which I'll explain. I started building a buyback protocol. We realized that a lot of people do this, and they don't talk to the FBI or Secret Service or deconflict. And deconfliction is the art of basically checking with them: do they have a case on this? Do they already have that data? Are we obstructing any, you know, are we breaking law or obstructing the case? Because if we go and buy back, there may be like a mission that we're interrupting, and it can be, you know, hurtful to the investigation, right? So part of that is that process is, you know, the policy I wrote was basically have a chain of custody of the actions you're taking, a letter of intent to talk about, this is basically Title 18 U.S.C. 1029, be basically a legal line of purchasing of counterfeit prices or information, basically passcodes, tokens, things like this. So basically, every single time I have to consider buying back, we have literally a lawyer set that are basically, we have a law firm separately, there's lawyers for both sides, they're actually literally doing this so that they protect the discovery, concerns everything, we write up a waiver, a letter of intent, we file that, we give that to the FBI or the Secret Service, we check with them on a deconfliction process, you know, and make sure that if there's any extra data, we report that to the FBI, the Secret Service, and the NCFPA for victim notification. And we also sanitize the data that is not there to comply with PCI compliance, and we encrypt the storage, and we do destruction, properly destruction as well. This is not our data. We are literally getting that information to them, and every single time we check first, and that's actually the number one thing they have to do, so.
And I just want to circle back. And circle back. And I did dodge your question a little bit on what is legal and active, but part of it is because I can't list it all, but the other is because we've actually been working quite a bit on trying to put together some guidance which isn't ready yet. And I see the audience, and I just wanted to say CSIS was a great forum bringing together experts from cybersecurity in order to talk about active defense. We put out a paper in conjunction with them about those discussions, about things that are worth exploring. We're trying to do a little bit more than that. We were waiting for the Cybersecurity Act because things were going to change. But you know, keep on looking at cybercrime.gov. I think you'll see more stuff coming out. We can't give you general legal advice. We're not your lawyers. We're the government's lawyers. But we do want to share our knowledge to help you guys protect yourself as best as possible and prevent crime. But I mean, on the buyback programs, this is something that's happening more and more in conjunction with law enforcement. It's not every type of data that you need to worry about. Really, it is about the unlawful possession or trafficking in unauthorized access devices. If they're your access devices, they're not unauthorized. So buying your own data back, that's probably something that is safe. If you're buying lots of data that include other people's, well, talk to your peers whose other data is it. Do they have a common interest in trying to find out, is this data that they want to know that is out there? And might they authorize you to possess that data so that it's not unauthorized possession? These are the sorts of things that, you know, I'm not saying they're easy, but they're things you can do to reduce your risk.
Yeah, and there's a caption in 1029 with intent to fraud or defraud. So that is why I brought up the intention waiver, the waiver, the letter of intent. So they're showing with the chain of custody of the FOSTA, what data do we have. And yes, if you can go out there and let people know, hey, we have this data, we don't want to keep it, you know, and that's why there's also central systems like NCF data will help get the Visa, get the MasterCard, give it all to the places. There are clear concepts that can actually help with this as well. Don't sell the data ever. It's not yours to do. I'm telling you, you want to get in trouble, and it's also unethical. Do not sell data that's not yours.
If I can take one step further beyond not using the data, if you're going to buy special PII or worse access devices, don't use it. Don't sell it. Don't use it.
Yeah.
But more than that, be very careful about talking to where it came from. Because we see a lot of people who are trying to engage to say, your system is vulnerable, you really ought to patch it. By the way, I can help you with that. And there's an uneasy negotiation that goes on, and you need to be very careful about not implying that you'll release the data and embarrass the company or do other things that come close to the line of extortion in trying to help them become more secure.
So it sounds like, as a whole, we're more comfortable with the idea that I could be allowed to buy back my own stolen data than that I would be allowed to take down servers or people who are attacking me. I'm curious, though, coming back to the question of sort of unintended consequences. Even if we're just talking about me buying back my own data or my, you know, block that includes my data, do you have concerns about sort of what that does to the market for stolen data, whether it legitimizes it, whether it encourages more theft, because now people know, oh, well, you know, everybody's willing to pay. Probably I'm willing to pay more for my data than somebody who wants to use it for fraud is willing to pay. And what do you think that does to sort of the economic models that the criminals are relying on?
I locate the evolution of the dark web's black markets as the central driver of the explosion sophistication in cybersecurity. I think, broadly speaking, the good guys are losing, and the reason we're losing is that there has been this fundamental innovation in the history of black markets. Black markets have existed for, let's round it to 10,000 years, and over the past 10,000 years, they usually depressed prices because you can't trust criminals. Even if you're a criminal, you can't trust criminals. In fact, we opened by speaking about this defenders and fundamentally on cooperation, right? So a few guys can cooperate, bad guys have a much harder time cooperating. But what the internet, or honestly social networking, has done is it's solved the pseudonymous reputation problem. This is why Amazon Marketplaces works. Buy the used book from BookLover 493. Now, you have no idea where he is. You just know that a million people gave him an average rating of 4.8, so you're not over. And that is essentially what now features in the criminal underground, the cybersecurity underground. And that's amazing. It's amazing. Because it means you can establish your reputation as a trusted vendor of crimeware without revealing enough information to get popped. And that's it, right? We have famous cases of organized crime where the reason why organized crime families work is because they could develop a reputation. But once we got our act together in terms of law enforcement and breaking those networks up, they became dramatically less profitable. Here is a place where you can be a trusted vendor. And the reason why that is making cybercrime so much more difficult over just the past, let's say, decade, is that it used to be that we were dealing with an array of guy who wrote Wicked Type C, and also knew how to launder money, like do crime. You know, to succeed at crime, you need crime skills. You need to know how to exfiltrate funds across borders and bribe your local police department and things like that. And that usually doesn't overlap in the same human being. being who like writes amazing UX code, right? Now that those guys can simply trade, we get specialization. So yes, as good guys, maybe we can cooperate better than the bad guys, but the reason why there's been this explosion is that we don't need generous cooperation if you have a functioning market that supports specialization. So as long as specialists can trade, then you have the invisible hand of cooperation, and it's formidable. And that's what we're dealing with. Now there's a professional class of criminals who didn't write the rootkit, they just know how to use the rootkit to make money. And that has led to just this hyper explosion. So really, the central feature of the central driver of what we're up against is actually this black market evolution. Everything else is just a consequence of it.
So I'm going to bring you back to my question, and I don't want to realize, what happens then to that market if all of a sudden we have more protocols that say, okay, even those of us who are not bad actors don't want to commit fraud have ways of going and spending our money in that market?
I think we entrench it. I think that it gets close to legitimization, and it doesn't get us closer to cracking the attribution problems that allow us to undermine it. So it's probably a step in the wrong direction.
Let me just say that I completely agree. Specialization is the thing that is most dangerous in cybercrime right now. That's why you see us focus on marketplaces. That's why you see us go after Silk Road 1 and Silk Road 2, and in fact, put down 400 document addresses on one day in cooperation with 17 countries across the globe in order to take down marketplaces. That's why we went after dark room, one of the most famous ones, not on the dark markets, but rather was its own online front forum that was on the open internet. So we're definitely with you. Forums are a big problem we're going after. The problem is that if we never get the people who are actually doing these things on the forums, they just find a new forum. And so that's why criminal prosecution remains a priority in order to deal with cybercrime. And even though I'm saying that we're not being as effective as we want to be, I think we have to keep at that because these top level people who can code this stuff, if they never get caught, they will find customers for what they know how to do. And that's why I feel strongly that my office plays an important role in cybersecurity.
I want to take some questions. I have to let you talk. I'm going to keep cutting you off. But if there are questions out there, I want to make sure we have time for them. If there are, then you talk about whatever you'd like to talk about.
I just wanted to ask.
Go ahead, and we'll see if we have anybody else. Yes.
So we've seen a lot of threats from state actors, we've seen threats from the criminal groups that you're talking about. And it seems to me that is there a problem then with prosecutorial zealousness when it comes to maybe the smaller actors that they can get? We've seen people get very long sentences, we see people get forum shopped around to different places, and we see people get sentenced on economic damages that never seem to show up on the balance sheets of companies. Is there a problem in attacking these little guys who might then be great hackers who might then have gone on to be the ethical hackers that we need, but actually in some way we're making things worse with overzealous prosecution?
I guess I'll just disagree with the premise that there is overzealous prosecution. I mean, if you look at it, there's over 55,000 federal crimes charged annually. There's, on average, less than 200 computer fraud and abuse act charges brought each year. And as for long sentences, certainly the way that these crimes occur, we have to charge them in ways because of evidentiary issues, for notice to the defendant about exactly what he's being charged with being wrong, which results in multiple counts, so multiple charges. And then statutory maxes can be high. But the actual sentences, on average, the guidelines call for less than 3 years of incarceration. The average sentence is less than 2 years of incarceration. I don't think you are seeing people hammering the small guy. I just think, everybody here might think of one case or two that they read about that they think, in that case, I disagree with what was done, but either it may be explainable with more investigation into what actually happened. Not everything is reported accurately. Or I would say, occasionally there's going to be an outlier and it doesn't prove the rule. I can tell you this, computer security researchers said they were worried about overzealous prosecution The department responded, we now have checks and balances, even on the prosecutorial side, never mind all the rights that are awarded to any federal criminal defendant. My office, under my team, now reviews every computer fraud abuse act charge brought in this country. So there was a request. I don't know that anybody's ever said Washington bureaucrats are involved, thank goodness. But to the extent that you wanted greater oversight to make sure we're applying the statute appropriately, we responded to the community's request.
Michael, with that statement, regarding the new cyber initiative and the laws that you get in Congress, can you add to that as far as the new laws that just approved and put in? Can you add to what you just said? That's the last.
So certainly we now have some new laws and they're helpful. They clarify that people can monitor their own networks and that they can share information private to private so that like entities can know what people like them are experiencing, and they can share with the government so that the government can take appropriate action and share that back to help people protect themselves. I think that's a big step in the right direction, but are we done improving our laws with regard to cybersecurity? Not by a long shot. The administration has proposed some reforms to the legal authorities that federal prosecutors use. We need some better tools to take away the profits, to deal with things like botnets, to deal with the insider threat problem, which outside hackers are a big threat. Inside hackers are still the majority of the threat cases. And we recognize that people are concerned about the breadth of that, so we've actually proposed that some of that authority be turned back and that some trivial conduct be explicitly made not criminal. So we're willing to balance, but we do need greater tools. We need additional offenses. We need additional enforcement authorities. And then we still need breach notification laws.
If I may say, you're here. And that's the point, is that if you want whatever you're requesting and stuff, you're here, that's the point. It's not like you're going to shout out to tell you all, it's like, hey, we're not here, we don't want to listen to you guys. You're here, and I think that's the whole point, is to get a chance, if you especially afterwards, get a chance to talk to you about this kind of thing. They take the suggestions, I know for a fact, because we said a bunch of stuff.
You have a question?
I have a question.
Yeah,
so, in the past decade, we've seen cyber threats move from what I would call surgical point of attacks or single point of attacks, for example, credit card fraud, moving to a more systemic attack, such as, for example, medical identity theft occurring within organized crime at regional centers of hospitals, Medicare, Medicaid, et cetera. So it's been a general movement from more of a micro to a macro level. So my question is, I'm particularly interested to hear if you see trends of, for example, the newer forms of fraud moving from, even more from, away from specific corporations and specific groups of individuals to larger ecosystems, for example, entire platforms with associated devices, et cetera.
I'll take the first one. That's as we deal with the dark web and the data and everything. A recent talk I was asked to write about deep and dark web trends for 2015, and I talked about how we see bad guys applying Elasticsearch to pretty much their forums, and they're the active filters, and like basically they're doing what we do. They're making platforms. That is actually extremely this. You gotta remember one thing about no matter what engineering, content is money, period. That's how that works, right? We're in the industry of content. Our industry is threat intelligence. If you get the best community quality of content, you make money, right? Like, and that's the thing, content is king when it comes down to it. So when you see the hierarchy going up to medical records or anything like that, if people are gonna buy it, they're gonna be sold. And right now, you can just get batched with data. When you hack into something, you just get batched with data and you can figure out what it is later. And then you figure out that there's always someone who wants to buy it. So, but we are seeing advanced platforms. I saw the other day on malware because the POS systems are renewing the chip and then finally get them. We're seeing aggressive malware POS development, and I saw literally air gap features. Like, they're literally competitively going, hey, I've got an air gap feature on mine. And I mean, literally, it took us almost 2 weeks to figure out what the heck that actually does and how that works, because they're not always available. But they're going for more and more data, and they're getting more aggressive about how they can. So does that help answer your question at all? So another thing that's actually fascinating when dark goes down, I have stats from 2011, 2005, unique finding sites, right? So totally tricking them later, but basically the cool thing about it is when dark code went down, because I looked at the stats this year, I said, why is August gone up? Like in onion sites, when literally like almost like 2,000 more onion sites just in August. And I'm like, that happened a lot. And I'm like, oh, dark code, take down. And guess what happened? Boom. Like they went to the dark, the deeper, darker web, right? Basically the highest. So they are that protocols, platforms, they are. And then the technology is getting more available. We're seeing more open source tools being used. So I kind of laugh that it costs $25 to take down the internet, and millions of dollars are protected. So it's like you said, it's a tough battle.
If I could take it in a different direction, I think you heard Brian Krebs this morning talk about how after the credit card numbers started selling, they were selling on the market for like $10. The market for data is cratering because so much of it is stolen. And so this is a completely just me telling you this is my prediction based off of no data. So take it for what it's worth. Fraud is not the future of cybercrime. Messing with you and getting you to pay to make it stop is the future of cybercrime. We're seeing tons of great innovations here at CES, and they're all being connected to the internet, which means that they are all new targets. How much are you going to pay when your refrigerator starts to defrost? You're going to calculate how much meat is in there and decide how quickly you want to pay to turn that on. So I think these are great innovations. We want to have them be secure. That's why my office needs the resources to protect it.
Protect those refrigerators.
But I do think you're going to see ransomware, especially with the increase in cryptocurrencies that make retail level cybercrime available to monetize that smaller payments. I think you're going to see that rather than more innovation.
So that raises, I think, a really interesting policy and legal question, which is, should there be any restrictions on how much and how easily I can pay somebody to get off of my machines or out of my stuff? Is there any benefit to restricting that in hopes that you actually put some limits on that market, or is that crazy enough?
Any incentive, basically, as close as you can get out of it, I think. And that's speaking of a non-lawyer.
Don't criminalize prostitution and consumption of prostitution. Right? Like, if you pay for it, it's still kind of...
Well, going back to what Michael said, that if you really want to curb it, you have to go after the economic model. If that's the future economic model, is there any way to go after that without telling people you can't do an unlimited amount of paying for people to stop messaging?
It's an interesting idea, not one I've thought about, not one I'm prepared to present a position on. But I will say, you know, in the meantime, until people start to figure out, oh, they're not going to pay because they fear being prosecuted for paying, there's going to be a lot of damage done out there. And if people can pay small amounts to stop the damage, it's very difficult if I'm not in a position to truly stop the pain. And right now, it's very difficult for us to stop the pain. More
Yeah. Actually, I think if they don't promote lying and fear of going to the law enforcement to say, hey, we actually had the first time we heard about it, the guy lying, he was CTO, he left the ex-former FBI agent. He was like, oh my, fine, still an FBI agent, he was in trouble. But like, in the reality, we can't do that because it's all our conditioning. We program them to know, you know, I'm not going to call out, just going to pay this. Need to take care of it. The ransomware is targeting businesses, you know, focus and stuff too. I mean, these people are going to get fired. I have logs and logs of like communication between the ransom, the hostage basically, and then the actual ransom, what do they call them? The kidnapper basically. And that's it. Also, in the US staff, in 3 months, CryptoLocker made $30 million. That's when the money is. It is an extortion. You know what I mean? So, because you get both sides of the wheel of it. So.
On that optimistic note, please join me in thanking our wonderful panelists.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Excellent. Great.
guys feel? All right. I see people who have not pulled out of their seats since 8 a.m. this morning. So putting together a program like this, engaging, hopefully you enjoyed it, learned a thing or two, that's hard work. There's no magic associated with it. But putting together a program like this in a six-month period, which is basically what we had at CES, while actually launching a startup, that is magic. So I wanted to just take a brief moment and thank all the people at CyberVista, the staff, the people at CTA, which is CES's host company, and of course our advisors and sponsors for supporting us to make this program actually happen. So just a quick round. And I'd like to thank our executive producer, Jenny Goldstein, who has done this thing before. Our sole direct sponsor, CSX, is the newest and latest certification offering from ISACA. It's a new cybersecurity offering, it's an incredible one, and they were kind enough not only to sponsor our breakfast, but they will actually be available at our booth in a bit, and with materials, and Montana Williams will be there to actually talk about CSX, how they developed it, why it's an amazing certification for the new generation of cybersecurity professionals. And I urge you to come and listen to them. We're really looking forward to partnering with ISACA and with CSX on their programming. So we are located in LVCC, right in the first floor, as I mentioned before. You can find Cybersecurity Marketplace, you can find us. We are the anchor of that marketplace. And last but not least, I'd like to thank Dell, who has been really kind to us to sponsor lunch, but is also sponsoring our reception immediately after this. So we do have a forum closing reception. It is at the Yardbird Restaurant, which is right here in the Mission on the first floor. And we have that available basically from now until 6:30 p.m. So thank you all for joining us for the inaugural CES Cybersecurity Forum presented by CyberVista. I hope we'll see you all next year and hopefully even before that. Thank you, guys.